So, Bhumi, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am, I'm all set.
Okay.
हेलो हेलो
Also, now, Isil?
Yes, ma'am, we should start.
Okay, so good evening, participants. Behalf of the manager, Father Blaise.
Good evening, ma'am.
On behalf of the manager, Father Blaise D'Souza, and our principal, Dr. Susama Samuel, a warm welcome to this My Mathematics webinar series 4 on strategies and solutions for boosting mathematics learning. We started off in June 2020 with series 1 on augmenting student engagement of elementary and children with special needs. Along with that, we also had another session on quality improvement in mathematics teaching. In July, we had constructivist teaching and learning for students' thinking. In August session, we had scaffolded problem-based learning strategy. And today we have two sessions, one for the primary level on aspects in effective math education and pedagogical content knowledge. Hope that our sessions are generating a stimulus to innovate and thus transforming mathematics education. If you have tried out any innovation, we request you to kindly send us a 1 minute video and communicate with us on our official email ID. So we will take off with mathematics series webinar 4, and our student coordinators for today are Alsona, Riesel, Nisha, Clarice, Rachel, Daya, and Vaseem. I thank all of them for their assistance to conduct this webinar. And without much delay, I hand over to Riesel to introduce our first speaker for the session. Riesel.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. Today, we have with us Ms. Bhumi Parekh to speak on aspects of effective math education. Ma'am has done her specialization in mathematics and has completed her B.Ed. from Hansraj Jivandas College of Education. Ma'am has previously worked with Shishuvan School and is currently working with Chhatrabhuj Narsi School at Kandivli as a grade 5 science and homeroom teacher. Their focus is on transforming students into confident and self-reliant individuals who are ready to negotiate challenges and create new pathways with determination. Ma'am, we are delighted and pleased to have you with us this evening. Once again, a warm welcome on behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education and a kind request to begin your session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So I'll present my screen and just let me know if that is visible.
For the question answer session, we have Rachel and Nisha. So Rachel and Nisha, kindly requesting you to take up the questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so hi everyone, a very good afternoon. I hope everyone is doing well. I know we all are grappling a little with the COVID situation, but I think it has become new normal for everyone now. So just to break the ice, I would like to know, how do you feel this Saturday? It's weekend, so just tell me how do you feel in the chat box. I will be showing you 4 bitmojis. You can relate to that and write whatever number you think suits you the best right now. So I would have a rough idea as to how my session would go ahead. So I'll just give you 30 seconds or 1 minute for this. And yeah, you can type your answers in the chat box. Okay, yeah, I see few of them. Okay, someone says 4, 1, 3. Okay, so we have, I think, okay, happy. Oh, cool. Everyone is all ready to run, I suppose. Someone is also very shocked. Okay, so I think, we do have people with mixed feelings right now. So I'll just make sure that at the end of this webinar, you have something to take away in your classes. So to start with, the topic that I will be dealing is okay, my screen is not moving ahead. I think I will share it again. Okay. So yes, the topic as correctly said by Dr. Winnie, it is aspects of effective math education. So I would just like to know, what do you think is the essence of mathematics as a teacher? What do you think is the most important thing that we want our students to know? Again, you can write the answers in the chat box. And ma'am, if someone could tell me the answers, that would be better, because I think when I...
Nichal and Nisha are there. So Nichal and Nisha... Okay. Give ma'am the answers from YouTube as well as the chat.
Yes,
ma'am.
So what do you think is something very important that we as teacher wants, we want our student to do that in mathematics? What is the basic thing that we want them to learn?
Ma'am, one participant says concept.
Absolutely correct. Yes, that is my first point too. The concept clarity is very important. Anything else?
Ma'am, the another participant says logical thinking.
Lovely. Yes. And where do we cut marks? If we don't see something, math teachers would love doing that. We deduct their marks for something. What do we call that as?
Steps, ma'am. The participants are saying steps.
Yes, so that's the procedure. That is absolutely correct. So I'm going to talk a little about the concept, procedure, and the third thing is the convention. Now, what is convention? So conventions are based on something which is very generally applied, and we believe them from ages. We don't know the real logics behind them, but we do follow it. So let's go ahead and start with the session. So I'm going to put this very straight question. You need to select which is the correct number line. I'm going to give you two options. And you can write the answers in the chat box. And even when you do this in your class, always make your students vote for something. And you can talk math over here by giving such questions. So if you can again read out the answers for me, Alsona.
Yes, ma'am. Everyone is opting for the option number one.
Lovely. I was expecting that. Yes. So because we are taught that is the correct number line. So your students would also do this. But do not stop here. So tell them, okay, I'm going to give you a question. This question out on both the number lines. So then you tell them to try it on the first number line. You tell them you are on -3. You need to move ahead 4 steps. And there you go. So 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the answer is 1. And you come to the conclusion that number 1 number line is absolutely correct. And then you tell them, try it with the second number line. And let them explore. And they will tell you that, okay, again, they get the same answer. So this is one of the convention that we have been taught, but we follow the same number line. But the answer, you will see that you get the same answer. So it is our duty to tell our students that number line is just a representation. It can be vertical, horizontal, diagonal. Explore them with all of this. It is just to broaden their view. And the reason why we follow convention is, ideally, there is no correct answer to any of it. But the concept won't change, as you could see in the number line 2 also. But we are so embedded with that first number line because that's how our teachers... Yes.
In the number line, when we add, are we not supposed to go to the right-hand side and not left?
Why do you go to the right-hand side, tell me? Because you have positives there.
Yeah.
So if you go to the second number line also, you have this towards left.
Okay.
So you will move towards left.
Okay, because we teach them like that, right? When you're adding,
yeah, no,
you go to the
right.
So...
I'm coming to that. Absolutely teach them the left and one, but yeah. I'm just trying to tell you, your thinking would change a little because you thought that left is always negative, so you won't go towards there. But right now, my number line has changed. I've got negative towards my right and positive towards my left. So they need to know this. Just because the teacher has told you to always move towards right because there are positive numbers, no, we don't follow it blindly. So if you see the second number line, they will think the way you started thinking. And that's what we want them to do. So yeah, I'll just tell you why did I do that. So the concept won't change. That is what I was trying to explain. And we follow the first number line because to standardize it, of course, we're not going to teach them and change their concept. But as they grow, they should know that what they have learned is a convention and the concept would definitely not change, but there are different ways of doing it. So that is why I had put that question. I hope I cleared your doubt there. Okay, so moving a little ahead, I want you to tickle your brain a little. I'm going to ask you a question which is very simple. I don't want the answer, but I'm looking for the different ways in which you can solve it. And to do this, we will be using a different app which is called as Leno. And I give you a link to this. So I'm going to stop sharing this and I'll take you to the Leno page first so that you understand how that looks. Okay, can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's my Leno page, which will open up in a bit. Yeah, can you see that?
Yes, yes.
So I will paste the link, but before that, I'll just show you how it works. So you will pick up a sticky note from the right hand side. You can write your answers, whatever you have to, and then you will put your name where it says tag, and then you will post it. So this, I just thought of adding this app, which you can use in your online classes also. So I'm going to now paste the link in the chat box. So please kindly go to that and just tell me what answers come to your mind, or in what different ways can you solve this. Okay, and I'm pasting it in 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Yeah, there goes the link. So, and if one of you could just read the answers for me, that would really help. So you get 30 to 1 minute to answer that, and then we can probably move ahead. Can you hear me?
Oh, yes, yes, we can.
Okay, okay, thank you. So, any answers?
No, not yet.
Okay.
We can't see any answers.
Okay.
We can't see this sticky notes. We can't see the sticky notes.
Okay, I think I will go to that so that, you know, I can see.
Yeah.
I'll do that.
But I went to it, but I couldn't see the sticky notes.
Okay, let me go and see that. Yeah, I am there, even I can't see. So I don't know if they, the participants are replying to this or not. You can also reply it in the chat box. This was just to introduce a new tool to you all.
Yeah, so they're
replying. Oh, yeah, I can see it now. So 20 minus 40 minus 20, that equals to 20 plus 2, that is 22 minus 3, 19. That is beautiful. Okay. Yeah, so I do see a few answers now.
Yes.
Okay, 40 minus 20, someone has done, someone has done it directly the way we are taught in school. 43 minus 24, absolutely 19. Yes, that is also correct. Yeah. So, yeah, that was just to, tickle your brain a little to tell you. Can you see my screen now, or will I again have to stop sharing and then go back to my PPT?
You'll have to go back to your PPT.
Okay. Yeah, so that was the idea of doing it. I understand you won't be able to do this in your classes every day or in your every classes, but at least when you start the chapter, let the students explore it like this, just to understand that there are different ways of solving something, but you would still get the same answer. Okay, I think I'll have to start again. So we were over here, I think. Yeah. So yeah, the answers that you would see on the Linoid page would be similar to what I have pasted. These are the answers which I got when I was teaching at Shishuvan. So yeah, it is just to give students this idea, because if this is clear, the next example that you will see, you will understand why this is very important. So again, what I'm posting or showing you right now is a real class scenario. When the teacher asked what is 3 plus 2 equals to dash and plus 1, and the options given to them were 5 and 4. So what do you think they would have answered? And to our surprise, they all said 5. And when we asked them why, they very innocently said 1 is just given to confuse us. Now, this doesn't mean that the child doesn't understand mathematics. No, that is absolutely incorrect. The child calculated it very well. 3 plus 2 is 5. So they were correct there. So where did it actually go wrong? So the understanding of the equal to sign is not clear with the child, which we, even as teachers, we don't do. We just teach them 3 plus 2 is 5. But what does that actually mean? So just a little over here also, you can explain your students that equal to means that you are balancing both the sides. It means that your left-hand side is absolutely equal to the right-hand side, and it can be any number. So allow them, even when someone tells you 5, you tell them, yes, that is absolutely correct, but is there any other way of writing that? So tell them to come up with different examples. So as I've written 4+1, 3+2, or writing 1 5 times, that is also absolutely correct. But we need to give the space to the students to explore a little more. This is also something which I have seen. We all do this. This is a very classic example. When we start teaching them subtraction, we tell them that I've got 5 chocolates in my hand. I'm taking away 3. So what remains? And they'll tell you 2. And we stop here. But I think this is where we need to take it a little further and also explore the middle term, which is unknown. So here also you can tell them, okay, I've got 5 marbles or 5 chocolates and I'm taking away something. And don't tell them how much or what you are taking away. And then tell them what remains is 2. So now tell me what is the answer. Let them calculate. Do not give them the answer. Do not teach them that you see 5 here, you see 2 there, you subtract that 2 and get the answer. No, let them do it. And once they give the answer, then you can, of course, open up your hand and show them what you actually have and tell them that, yes, that's the correct answer. And similarly, you can also do the first term missing. So again, over here, you tell them that you've got some chocolates in your hand. You are adding 2 more to that. And finally, what you have is 5. So now, can you tell me how many did I had previously? So we need to make sure that we give space students to explore all this also, rather than just directly pushing them to word problems. So this is just building up on their basics so that when they come to word problem, it really helps them out. Okay, now to move ahead, I'm going to post again 2 questions. I don't want the answer, but I want to know, how do you calculate this orally? Again, you can type your answers in the chat box, and I would really like to listen to your answers to this as to how do you really calculate. If you see, they both are subtraction, but the way you calculate is a little different. What do you do in the first one and what do you do in the second one? So, Alsona, if you can just read a few answers for me.
Yes, ma'am. So, some participants have written 100 minus 3.
Okay, no. So, now this time I'm not looking for different methods, but how do you do this really mentally? How do you do? Do you really count from 2 up to 99? How do you do this? Or do you actually do 16 minus 14? How do you do this mentally?
We go back. We Perfect. Do backward counting, yes. arrange yes. the ones below ones.
Yes, so I was looking for that. In the first one, you will do backward counting. And in the second one, you will do a forward counting from 14 up till 16. So how did you do this? We were not taught this in the school, but we are doing this. Why? Because we have that estimation. We know that this is an easier method and it'll save your time. But we need to allow students also to come up to this, okay? So that was one example of estimation. And now I'm going to show as to how this estimation would also help them in division. Division is also something that I've seen teachers are also a little scared to teach this, and students are also a little, they do grapple with this also. And if you think that students don't understand division, I would really not agree to that, because they do have a fair knowledge of it. It's just that we need to do it in a little different way. So to start, what I do in my classes, I show them this picture. I tell them that this is a birthday party of your best friend and he's kept a cake for you. The condition is you need to go and sit somewhere, and remember, wherever you sit, the cake would be equally divided. So where would you go and sit? So I've given the pictures to you. You can write your answers in the chat box. And when they answer, you need to tell them, why did you select that? And listen to their reasoning. You can also use this for your fractions. Any answers there also now? Any answers?
Ma'am, they have written
2 and 3.
Yes.
Okay. 3, as I don't like cake.
Yeah, that is great. But you tell them that that's your favorite cake
first.
Yeah, so mostly they would select one, saying that because, you know, they like cake to eat and they would want all the cake for themselves and they would not like to share. So they might opt one, but if they say 2 and 3, you need to find out why and then you can see what their reasoning is. If it is not their favorite cake, then you put something which they really like. You tell them, imagine that. And then they would tell you. And even if they say they would select 3, they still have that understanding that they'll get a little small piece so that they can avoid what they don't like eating. So yeah, you can start with this. Again, over here, you do not tell them division or the word divisor or dividend, anything. Just show this picture and then you start with this. You tell them always that we will be doing something related to equal sharing. So as you see in the picture, I will also show you a video of it. So you start with pictorial representation with division. Do not directly go to division. And then you ask them probing questions. So I will just show you this video and then we will talk about it a little more. This year, the teacher was doing it, but when I did at Shishuvan, I actually made a group of 5 to 6 students. I would number them each, and then I would call up randomly. I would say number 3 from each group come out, and then I would give them a chit, which they would pick up, which would have a word problem similar to this. They would go back to their group. They would have slate and chalk with them. They would draw and show me, and then I would ask them, so how many did one child get? How many did two child get? Is there something that is remaining? So initially you do not give them anything where you have remainders, but by the end of this class, you can introduce something wherein you have remainders also. And after you are done with this, you can take it forward in the grid format. Now, again, this is a very beautiful way of doing it. Again, I'll show you a video to this as well. So yeah, let's see the video.
Let's get started. We are going to divide 45 by 5. We have here 10 columns moving from 1 to 10 as you can see, and we have 8 rows here across. So let us concentrate on number 5. As this is 5, our divisor is 5, I'm only going to use these first 5 rows, and I have with me these counters which are 45 in number. So we start placing these counters, and please remember, we are only using first 5 rows. So I am going to fill in counters in each of these columns, but only till the 5th row. Isn't it easy? I still have a lot of counters left. How many counters did I start with? 45. Why? Because my number which is to be divided by 5 is 45. And I am only filling till 5 rows because I am dividing by 5. You will have to remember this. We are on our last column. So let us see what happens. My counters
so
are finished.
This was also great, but again over here, I do not use the word division up till here. I do this again with equal sharing only. So you can try this out. It worked very well when I tried this out. And after this session, you can take them to the real division and teach them how we do it. And to go ahead, again, there is when we teach them this method, there's something wherein they again go wrong. So I just thought I'll put this also. So they would solve this by saying that 4 ones are is 4, you get 0, you bring back 16, and 4 fours are is 16. So this is also a very classic mistakes which students do at times. So to solve this, when you do this division, you also simultaneously show them something like this. You tell them, okay, so the number is 416. Now we need to divide this by 4. So let us first split the number. So we split it into 2, that is 416. And the operation remains the same. We are dividing both the numbers by 4. And when you do this, they'll tell you that 400 za is 400 and 4 fours za is 16. And then when you add it, you get 104. And then you can ask them to go back to their division long method of division and ask them, where did we go wrong? So if they have a fair knowledge of estimation, they would never say that 14 is the answer. So if you do it this initially for a few sums, it might really help the students to clear their doubts. So this is one of the way you can make a long division a little simple initially. And the real fun questions for division, which I found were, which you don't see in the textbook, is you just tell them solve a sum wherein you have remainder as 0. Again, make them sit in the groups and tell them to explore and share their numbers with their friends. There'll be so many numbers and they will all be very curious to see what their friends have used. And the second one, what I give them is I just tell them that I want the quotient as 10. You do whatever you want, but I want the quotient as 10. So they will figure it out. They'll work on their own to come up to this answer. And similarly, you can tell them you can take any number, but divide it by 12 and show me the answer. So this is just to tickle their brain a little more. Okay, I'm gonna now talk about fractions as well a little. How do we start fraction? What is the most common way that we all teachers love to use? I have seen most of us using either pizza, roti as an example. But I would suggest again to use a square shape first, because it gives them a more, they understand it better in square compared to circle. They can visualize square in a better way than circle. So you first start with a square shape and avoid saying that if I cut it into two parts, because that two parts can be in very different ways. Ideally, we are not trying to cut that hole. We are trying to complete that hole. Okay. So I would suggest that we do not use the word cut it, but what we can use is we make them understand the concept of whole first. We tell them, this is my whole, okay? This is my shape that I am looking forward to. And then you can have questions related to that. You can tell them, how many pieces will I need to complete this shape? So then you say that the shape remains the same and you show them the shape. And you tell them, how many this shape would I require to complete the whole? And if they cannot, you actually pick up the piece and you put it on that shape. And then you tell them to visualize. So here you also try to probe them a little with the abstract thinking, and then they'll come up saying two. So you'll say, that's correct. So how do we write this if I'm just asking you about that pink shape? So they'll say, how many pink shapes do I have? So they would say one. And then you ask them, how many would I need in all to complete that shape? So they'll say two. So that is when you introduce the fraction to them. You tell them what we write up about the fraction line is called as the numerator. That is generally the shaded part or the part that is representing something or the part that is asked. And down we write the denominator, that is that the entire shape can be filled in or can be divided into those many parts. And then again, you can show them as many shapes as possible. So I would actually call one child out and ask them. So you can have again something which is horizontal. You tell them, now place this and tell me how many this shape would I require. You can again go a little more deeper and explore with the shape. Get something like this. Tell them, will this ever fit in this? And you actually go and try and fit in. And they might say no. And then you ask them, is there any other way? What if you twist it and turn it a little? Can it then fit in? So let them explore all that. And let them come to this shape, let them arrange it on their own and tell them that, yes, even this is a half shape. And then you can go a little more deeper and get the shapes, get them little more smaller shapes and tell them how many of this shape would I require to complete the whole. And if they don't get it, you can then pick it up, place it on the shape, and you think about it. So after placing one or two, they'll tell you, yes, ma'am, you'll require three to complete this whole. And similarly, you can go a little more deeper and you can get it more, little smaller, cut little more smaller pieces. And again, you can place it and ask them. You can do it till they do not, you don't have to fit in all their shapes. So this is again, just to ask you as to how would you use fractions to distribute this among students? So give this question to your students. Again, this is a pictorial representation. We are still not going or starting with the numbers full-fledged. So you tell them you have two students and you have to divide this among three students. So how would you do it? So you would come up, the students would come up with various ways. So it is just to let them explore that there are many ways of doing it. So they might say that, you know, I can give the first one directly to the first child, the second one to the second, and then I can divide the third one and give one to each. Or you might find students telling you that, you know, I'm going to divide all the three and I will give one each. And again, I've got this tool which we can use right now and try it out. I'll give you a little time to explore this. This is FATE, which gives amazing stimulations and they are very interactive. So I will again paste the link to this in the chat box and you can explore this a little as well. And once you are done, you can just give a thumbs up in the chat box so that we know that you people have explored this as well. And I'm pasting it in the chat box. Try it out and let me know how it works.
Vinny ma'am, we can share it, share the link on YouTube also.
Yeah. So there'll be two options when you go. You can select either the simple fractions or the mixed fractions, whichever you want to explore.
Yes, I put it up on the YouTube.
Yeah, thank you.
Not able to open the link.
Is that with everyone? I can share my screen and show you how it works.
No, ma'am, I don't think it is with everyone. I could access it.
Okay, thank you. Okay, should we go ahead? Any answers in the chat box? Did they explore this?
It's working, they said.
Okay, okay. So again, if you see the questions out there, they look very simple, but they will make you think as to how would you balance the fractions. So just to clear their concept out a little, you can use this app. They have app also, and you can use it directly with the link the way I've shared it with you.
Density ka point as its extent.
Should we go ahead? I mean, I'm almost done. I just have to give one more last thing.
Yes, ma'am. People have responded that it is a very interesting and a very great app.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So you can have other things also in this. So ideally, I came up to this app when I was teaching science. But then to realize that they also have simulations for math. So you can connect this with your topic and you can use this. So you can use this for math also and science. So I think this was my almost last thing. And I'm going to end it by, okay, I can't move ahead again. I'll have to present the slides again. So I'm going to again paste a link in the chat box. And this time it is for a jigsaw puzzle, which you can use in your online classes. So I think, yeah, that was my almost last slide. So, yeah. So jigsaw is also something I would want you to play a little and get a little hands-on to that also. I would paste the link in a minute. So what I have used Jigsaw right now is just for a very simple thing, but you will get topics related to your subject as well. So try that out and see how it works for your class. I'm sharing the link in the chat box. So again, this is a very fun way. So I again used this in science when I was teaching them different paths to flowers. We were revising that. So I gave them this jigsaw, they played it and they could revise all the different parts of flowers. So you can use this in math also. You have for 2D shapes and 3D shapes also. So you can use it for that. And just let me know how this works. Is the link there in the chat box? Can you open up the link?
Yes, ma'am, we can open.
Okay. I think they are asking to share it on WhatsApp also. Out of the Zoom.
Okay, I'll do that.
Yeah, thank you. So yeah, that was it from my end. You can ask me questions. I would try my best to answer them. I'm not very sure. I haven't been doing math since 1 year, but I would try to answer your questions.
Okay, ma'am, the first question from the participant is that how can we use effective maths education to encourage risk-taking among students?
Taking risk, I mean, in real life or how are they connecting?
Ma'am, like, I guess they are talking regarding the division method, like how can they explore many methods, many more methods? So,
see, I do understand we do have this time crunch, but if their basic is not clear, there is no point in rushing and completing the portion. So start with something very simple, what they do in real life. Try to connect with that. So what I did was sharing it equally, something that we all do in our life. So it's just you are bringing it to your class. And then you take from there to the grid method, which is more standardized and you have numbers playing in. And then you teach them the real method that we all do in our school, the long division method. So I think that should really help. It might take your one or two classes, but in long run, it will definitely help the student. I hope that answers your question. Can you suggest
yes, ma'am.
Of online games to make it interesting? So faith is something that I came across, which can be used for many topics. Other than this, I think even in the first webinar, I think with Zara took, she had given us something for addition and subtraction. So that also works very well. You can also try that out.
Ma'am, one more participant is asking a question that how can they explain HCF and LCM?
So even this can be done with pictures first, HCF and LCM. The way we did fractions, you can do LCM and HCF also like that. And again, when I did this with them, we had two or three other methods also. So Shishuvan was a school wherein we had to do everything hands-on. So we did bring in something first hands-on and then we take them to the standardized method. But we give them two, three methods. Rather than just pushing them with one thing, just to make sure that their concept is very clear. So you can explore a few hands-on there as well and then take them with the real way or method of solving it.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Ma'am, there's one more question. Then how to boost them to learn multiplication tables?
Yeah, so for multiplication, I would suggest do not make them write. I mean, that doesn't work with them. What you can do is every morning in your class, when you go, you can tell them to say it openly, orally. So do not always just start with 2 ones are 2 twos. You can also at times start from behind, 2 tens are 2 nines are 2 18s are. Tables can only be done like that. So, and make it very interactive. Suddenly ask anyone from your class. So, you know, everyone is very alert. And if they don't answer in those seconds, you go to the next child. So day by day, they would practice a little more and they would want to answer with that speed. So that might help. But revise tables every day, especially when they are small in grade 1 to 5. You can do that every day.
What are you studying now?
Ma'am, there's one more question. How to remove the fear of maths in students who don't enjoy maths?
Right and wrong. When you tell them what you've done is right or what you've done is wrong, or when you bring in marks in the picture, that is when they fear mathematics. So initially, whenever they are solving something, you would tell them, okay, you know, you can try this out, probe them with that. Even if the answer is wrong, you tell them, how did you get this answer? Ask them a little more question. And then you can tell them, then you show them the way rather than just telling that, you know, you are absolutely wrong. It doesn't work like that. And most of them in primary would go wrong because of their mental or, you know, tables. So make sure that that foundation is very clear. And if I think that is clear, they would really never fear mathematics.
Thank you, ma'am. That's all questions from the participants.
There was one question which I just saw on YouTube, and I think it's a very interesting question, but the question is in Hindi. So I would like to ask. So the participant is actually asking that, like I'll translate it in English. So the question is, for language, we need skills such as listening, hearing, and talking. So like that, for maths, what are the skills required? The main skills that a teacher should be focused upon?
I would say one is logical reasoning. And the second one would be, how can you relate it to your real life? Math is something that we do on and off, even without knowing. We use it in our daily life. So if you connect that to the child, or, you know, if you give them those examples directly, they will relate it more and they will go more correct there. So listening, yes, of course, listening skills would also help. But logical reasoning is something that you require in mathematics, I would say.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. So, Bhumi, are you satisfied with the questions, or is there any more questions, Rachel and Alsona and Nisha? Any more questions?
Ma'am, someone is asking, what are the main skills to teach maths?
For a teacher, I would say clarity of the concept is very important. The procedure or the steps, we can still juggle a little with those. We need to also be a little more open to what students tell us at times. So if there is any other way, just be more open to that, listen to that. And if it really works out, you should encourage that, I would say.
Questions?
There is one more.
Okay.
2-digit multiplication the child can do, but 3-digit going wrong. Can you suggest how to improve?
If the child is able to do 2-digit and not 3, okay. So the only change is you put a 0 there, 2 zeros when you go to the 3-digit. So why then the child should also have problem in 2 digits, I think. If the child is able to understand 2, then 3 shouldn't be a problem. But then still, you can find out where the child is exactly going wrong, and then you can tackle that problem.
Okay, I think we should move on now. So all of us have seen that Bhumi is such a young teacher and she's so enthusiastic and so innovative. I really want to appreciate her presentation, the way she has presented, and the ability to think beyond a particular way of teaching is the best part of this session. And Bhumi has made us break through all our, you know, our set ways of teaching. So thank you, Bhumi, for that, for giving us that input. And it was a very good session, well presented. I would request our student coordinator, Clarice, to propose the vote of thanks for this session.
Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for the first session of SXI Maths webinar. So on behalf of SXI, Manager Father Blaise D'Souza, Principal Dr. Susama Samuel, Staff in Charge Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, and all the student coordinators, I extend a hearty vote of thanks to our speaker, Ms. Bhumi Parekh, who spared time from her busy schedule for this webinar. Today, we have been privileged and had the amazing opportunity to hear your session. I'm sure that all the information you gave to make maths education effective and the resources that you suggested will immensely help us in our respective fields. Thank you once again, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Clarice will give some instructions to the participants.
Yes. So there are some instructions. So there will be a 10 minutes break until the next session, and the participants are requested to be present on time.
So we'll begin at 4 p.m. For the next session. Thank you. Please don't leave the meeting. Please be present in the meeting itself. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Yeah, I'm ready.
No? Yeah. Narendra, yes, sir. Ready. Abhi, Dr. Susama, ma'am, has just joined.
Hello, Vinnie.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am. So, ma'am, we had a very good session. The first one is very nice.
I missed it.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. Who is this?
Who is this?
Who is this?
That is one of our participants, probably from school.
Oh, my God. So, I missed it, actually. Hello, sir. Dr. Narendra, sir. Narendra Deshmukh, sir.
Hi, how are you?
I am fine, sir. How are you, sir?
I am also fine. Thank you.
Yes, sir. So after a long time, sir, we are meeting together today.
Dr. Rahul, ma'am is also with us.
Okay, okay. Yeah, Dr. Rahul. Yeah, Dr. Satyavadi Rahul, madam.
Yes, yes.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, Father Blaze has also joined us.
Joined. Okay, okay.
Good afternoon, Father. Yes, Father is there, yeah.
Yes. Good afternoon, Father.
Good afternoon to you all.
Yeah.
So, Father, we finished one session.
Yeah, I watched that whole session. I just came in and you locked it up.
Okay. So sorry, Father.
I watched from YouTube.
Okay.
So, it is in the YouTube now, Vinny. It is in the YouTube.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sir.
So it is 4:00. We will start with the next session, ma'am. So,
okay.
Yeah. So we had a very enriching session. The first session was very enriching by Bhumi Parekh and we learned a new method of looking at different concepts. Now we move on to the next session on pedagogical content knowledge, which is presented by two eminent teachers, I must say, in the field of science and mathematics together. So we are so happy to have them. And I request Vaseem and Nisha to introduce the two speakers. Over to Vaseem.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Hello, Vaseem. I'm so sorry. Just please wait. I would request Dr. Susama Samuel, our principal, to say a few words. Ma'am, I'm really sorry.
No, it's okay. They can introduce. After that, I will speak. No problem.
You speak first, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So, good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education, I welcome all participants to this webinar on mathematics strategies and solutions for boosting mathematics education. Our manager, Father Blaise D'Souza, our today's resource persons, Bhumi Naresh Parekh, Dr. Satyavadi Rahul, and Dr. Narendra Deshmukh, sir. All three are, what Vinny said, same well-known personalities, eminent teachers from science and mathematics education. And I welcome them on behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education. And also I welcome our Vinny Sebastian, who is in charge of our mathematics unit, mathematics pedagogy unit, Dr. Vinny Sebastian, and all students from mathematics pedagogy unit, my colleagues, those who are participating in this webinar, the teachers and all participants, all are welcome to this program. I missed the first program. Definitely I will be watching it in the YouTube. I think she spoke on aspects of effective mathematics education. Today's theme is pedagogical content knowledge. So pedagogical content knowledge, usually or shortly known as PCK. We usually say PCK. Recently, I saw a new term which is joined with PCK is technological PCK. It means we are combining technology with pedagogy and content knowledge. Pedagogical content knowledge makes teachers very special, or even we can say that it is very challenging for the teachers, because the scope of pedagogical content knowledge goes beyond pedagogy and content knowledge. It deals with the teacher who knows her subject, a teacher who knows how to teach well, clearly and effectively, and also a teacher who understands students and understands students from where they come from, and students' different perceptions, the strategies, what the students were using, and the knowledge of diverse pedagogies. So this integration of subject matter, pedagogy, the students and learning environments are crucial to good teaching and students' understanding. Definitely, this integration, there will be various issues also related to this, because this integration is not an easy task. Our today's resource persons, Dr. Narendra Deshmukh, sir, is a very familiar person, senior scientific officer from Homi Vabha Science Center for Education. And also, he was a friend of all of us. Will definitely speak in depth about teachers, pedagogy, content, students, and how to integrate all these factors to bring the best for student community and teacher community. And Dr. Satyavadi madam is new to me. So ma'am, I am really very much excited to listen to you. This webinar series is the fourth session, fourth series on mathematics education. And the other sessions were also on various pedagogies and various pedagogies we have discussed. The resource persons have brought new innovations, and also one paper was on a research paper. The purpose of this webinar is to boost mathematics education and develop confidence in students, and also to remove their difficulties or backwardness in mathematics and help teachers to teach mathematics with more interest and with more likings and interest the subject to the students. This is an initiative of our mathematics pedagogy unit, so Dr. Vinny Sebastian's initiative.
and she is our associate professor from St. Xavier's Institute of Education. So this time I am using this opportunity to thank her and also to appreciate the effort. Every month she is taking effort in conducting these sessions. She is calling the resource persons, arranging the sessions. So definitely it's a great thing from her. So congratulations to Vinnie. And also I request you to move in the same tempo and conduct this program in the future also. So all the best to all speakers, all the best to Dr. Satyavadi ma'am and Dr. Narendra Deshmukh sir, and all the best to Dr. Vinnie, and all the best to all participants, those who are today participating in this program. Over to Dr. Vinnie Sebastian.
Thank you, ma'am, for those encouraging words. And I think, you know, you have already set our minds thinking in the direction of the topic. I would request Father Blaise, if he would like to speak a few words. Father? Father Blaise? Okay. So, and hello. I now request yes, Father. Father, you're there?
Yes.
Father, you would like to just speak a few words, Father?
I don't have anything more to say than what Dr. Susama has said. I will only say that I welcome you all, and mathematics is considered to be a tough subject, but I think with this webinar, Dr. Vinnie, you have made it simple for so many teachers to be able to communicate what mathematics needs to students right from a young age onwards, so that they grow to get interested in mathematics and take it as enthusiastically as they do other subjects. And it is my hope that these inputs given by our resource persons will go a long way in helping us to make good mathematics teachers. Welcome to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. Now over to Waseem for the introduction. Waseem and Nisha for the introduction of the speakers. Narendra sir, Dr. Satyavati has logged out. Hello.
I think please allow her to enter. Hello.
Yes, sir. We are looking into it. Waseem, can you go on with the introduction?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Dr. Narendra Deshmukh is working at Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, TIFR, Mumbai, India, as Senior Scientific Officer. Sir has completed his MSc in Animal Physiology, MAd, MA, MPhil, and Doctorate in Education. Sir has also completed his MBA in HR. Since 1991, Sir has been working and doing research in students' conception and misconceptions, open educational resources, activity-based science learning, participatory action research, topic-specific pedagogical content knowledge. Sir is interested in tribal and rural education, health education, biology education, and teacher education. Sir has shared his research experiences in many national and international conferences and published in journals. Sir is author of 6 books, participated in 4 books, 3 technical reports. Sir has also associated with many national and international educational biology education research associations. Thank you.
Requesting Nisha to introduce Madam.
Good evening all. Dr. Satyavati Rahul was born on 29th October 1948. She has many degrees under her belt. BSc B.Ed. with Science and Mathematics, M.Ed. M.Sc. with subject chemistry, M.Phil. in education, doctorate in education, and also postgraduate diploma in applied linguistics. Madam has worked for 24 years as a teacher educator in SNDT University from 14 June 1984 till October 2008. She has taught subjects mathematics and science teaching, educational psychology, and educational technology. Madam has also worked in two different colleges related with Mumbai University as a teacher educator. She has also worked as a guide and counselor for in-service postgraduate teacher education program of Open University YCMOU. Till today, she has guided more than 20 M.Ed. and one M.Phil. student of this Open University. She has also worked with NGOs like World Life Fund, Hoshangabad Science Teaching Program Eklavya, and other organizations like Marathi Vidyan Parishad, Lok Vidyan Sanghatna, involved in science and environmental education as a resource person. She has also worked in different in-service teacher training programs organized by CASP Plan as a resource person. She was also involved in developing audio-visual, that is films and audio cassettes, and printed materials like self-learning modules for teaching mathematics for teacher community under the CASP Plan and Educational Technology Department of Maharashtra State. Lastly, she also worked as a teacher educator and an adjunct professor in KJ Somaya College of Education after her retirement in 2008. Thank you.
Sir, we are trying to get Madam, but she said she's trying to log in. So will you begin?
I'm trying, Madam.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir, ma'am is trying. So can you begin?
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Okay.
You just allow her to enter. So
yes, we are looking at the waiting room.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am has entered. I have admitted her.
Okay, good, good. That's good.
But she's still joining.
Okay. Good afternoon, honorable manager, honorable principal, ma'am. Maths webinar series coordinator, Professor Winnie ma'am, and all esteemed webinar participants. It's our pleasure and honor to share with you our own understanding about pedagogical content knowledge. And thank you. I would like to thank St. Xavier College of Education for organizing such a wonderful webinar series for mathematics. And I think in our country, it's a need to enhance or to foster mathematics education. And I think St. Xavier is working in that direction. Really, congratulations to all of you. In this presentation, we would like to share with you our some ideas about content knowledge. And in this session, especially my focus is on topic-specific pedagogical content knowledge. We call it a TSPCK. Principal ma'am mentioned that TPAC, Technological Pedagogical Content Knowledge. This is another word we have to understand what is meant by topic specific pedagogical content knowledge. I asked myself, does this knowledge of teaching apply to other subjects as well? Or is it different in different subject matters? I thought that let me share with you. I am not from mathematics background. Let me tell you. Dr. Raul ma'am, as just now we we heard her introduction that she is a teacher educator in particularly math education, and her work, lot of developmental work, and her what you can say research area is also math education. So we discussed that I would like to share with you that component of topic specific pedagogical knowledge. Particularly if we see the pedagogical content knowledge, almost many things are applicable for all subject, not necessarily whether it's a history or geography or language or science or math, even for engineering or even for medical sciences also. So apart from this pedagogical content knowledge, we will try to understand this topic specific pedagogical content knowledge component of that topic specific TSPC case. First of all, I would like to know that what do good teachers know? That's the first question. And just now, in the first session, Bhumi Madam explained very nicely various components almost she covered for a good teachers that require to deal, you can say, very diverse culture, classroom structure. Anyone can share or anyone can talk. What do good teachers know? Someone to read.
Participants can unmute their mic and answer sir's question.
Content knowledge.
Okay.
So one person has written in the chat that teachers should know their students well.
Yeah, very good.
They should have good rapport with the students. They should go beyond marks and tests.
Okay.
They should also understand the context of the students.
Yes, context is very important.
They should be open to new methods.
Mm-hmm.
They should act as facilitators by going to the level of the students and understanding their level.
Okay. Thank you. Basically, if we see, these are the things one can add many more. As I mentioned, someone that content knowledge is very important. Bhumi also pointed out that clarity of concept is very important as a teacher. And then general pedagogical knowledge, as we discussed many things, as we listed many things. Basically, in general pedagogical knowledge, we try to understand the broad principle and strategies of classroom management and organization, learner and learning knowledge, similarly assessment, then purpose and aim of that topic. This comes under the general pedagogical content knowledge, pedagogical knowledge. And at the same time, what the learner know and don't know or understand, that is also one thing as a teacher we should know about that things. And then what their learner like and don't like, that is also a thing. And the another party, another characteristic you can say, that is school context. That school context is very important, because the class create, as a teacher, we have to create a learning environment. For learning environment, we need a, first we have to focus on classroom culture, to create a classroom culture in that infrastructure, then the school or the college, their philosophy, their aim and objectives, the background of the students, everything comes under this school context. Similarly, this pedagogical content knowledge, the term, Before that, I would like to share with you that as a human being, we are inherently complex, and we have history, background, experience, emotions, knowledge, and goals. We make assumptions, recognize the tradition, make sense of information, you know, believe, and take actions. All these things happen as a human being. And in some cases, we recognize and can articulate the basis for our actions. All these things, in other words, we cannot seem to act on instinct. And these things are very important for the professional learning of teacher. And the process of professional learning is a continuous process, is an ongoing process of knowing, building, and skill development in effective teaching practices. That thing is also very important. While understanding PCK, PCK is basically how teacher transform their content knowledge to make available. That is a very important point. And in this context, we will see different educationists or researchers' view about knowledge transformation, how it takes place. And the term PCK coined by the Schulman, and for specialized knowledge known only by the teacher, that is very important. And at the same time, Schulman also that most of the teachers don't even know they have it. That means PCK, and they cannot describe it when you ask them. So these things are very important. As a teacher educator or as a teacher teacher, in future if you would like to do research, this is another area where we can work on, and even the we can develop a material or develop certain strategies based on this understanding of PCK. So what are the evidence of teacher knowledge? When we say the teachers are not aware about their own PCK, evidence are very simple. Whatever the ideas or whatever they taught, they identify what are the main ideas to be taught. They know what learner will and won't understand. And I think slowly we understand. Basically, I would like to add one point. Here, when we are saying teacher education, it includes pre-service teacher education as well as in-service teacher education also. During pre-service teacher education, our aim and objective basically of learning this or knowing this PCK is to understanding the depth of PCK, implication of the PCK, and where can we use this PCK. That's a but practicing teacher or in-service teachers, they can slowly learn what are the main ideas of some topic. Just now, number and then even from science, if we take a concept of photosynthesis, what are the big ideas? As a teacher, which things are important from concept photosynthesis that I supposed to transfer to the learner, my learner. So that is very important. At the same time, they know what learner will and won't understand. They use a representation, various representation. In the previous session, number line, the term used as a representation. They know what is difficult and why. Because as a teacher, slowly we analyze what are the difficult concepts in a certain from a certain topic or from a certain chapters, and why they are difficult. What are the reasons behind their difficulty? Slowly we understand these things, And teachers know that how to deal such a things. What are the different ways to overcome these difficulties, student learner difficulties? They know when to leave something out. And sometimes teachers are aware about this this fact also. Pedagogy PCK is the unique knowledge that teacher use in their teaching. That's a very important thing. And Lee Shulman defined PCK as a teacher interpretation and transformation of subject matter knowledge in the context of facilitating a student's learning. And he proposed several key elements of pedagogical content knowledge. Just now we discussed knowledge of representation of subject matter, understanding of student conception of the subject and the learning, and teaching implications that were associated with the specific subject matter, general pedagogical knowledge that also we discussed, then curriculum knowledge, knowledge of educational context, knowledge of purpose of education. All these things are very important. And basically, PCK is nothing but it's a special amalgam of knowledge possessed by the teacher. So, effective subject teaching, the word effective is also again problematic. But for sense making, we can say, because this is important, understanding means sense or making means or sense making. Lampert argued that people talk a lot in classroom, but they don't always pay careful attention to whether the talk is being understood or not. And at the most basic level, we might compare teaching with telling and learning with the listening. But teaching for understanding is much more than telling and learning with understanding. Teaching involves more than just listening. That is also important. And it means the conversation in the classroom is dominated by a question, does this make sense to you and why or why not? Such question during teaching, teacher is supposed to ask himself or herself. Lampert said that in my classroom, I use the word communication to replace the word him. And what I mean by communication is that not only are you responsible for expressing your ideas, or you are also responsible for finding out whether the person you are talking to understand what you are talking about. That notion applies to both the teacher and the student. That is also important. And the mathematicians, particularly all these names are well known in mathematics education or mathematics education research areas. Lampert, Deborah Ball, Liping Ma, Cheek, and then Lava and Eger. All these are the well-known personalities in the mathematics education. Deborah Ball and Hill argue that for effective mathematics teaching require knowledge of mathematical content, knowledge of students' thinking, and knowledge of how to represent the content so that it makes sense to other. These are the things. And if we analyze Bhumi's lesson, almost many of the components she covered during her session. So for sense making, all these things are very essential. And Liping Ma used the phrase profound understanding, or you can say the clarity of concept, or you can say depth of content. So profound understanding of fundamental mathematics to identify the deep understanding of mathematics that teachers need. Also, Cheek and her colleague identifies the key component of PCK within three broad categories, which include clearly PCK, then content knowledge in pedagogy, pedagogy context, and pedagogical knowledge in a content context. Basically, clarity PCK teaching strategies means general discussion or uses of general strategies or approaches for teaching a mathematical skill or concept. This clarity, the clearly PCK teaching strategy also include student thinking, student thinking and misconception, or their difficulties, cognitive demand of task, all this, and knowing of example, various as a teachers, because one example for explanation of any concept is not sufficient. Teachers should know many examples, because the classroom is our diverse classroom, heterogeneous, and various different learning skills, or you can say students have a different background. So as a teacher, this PCK is trying to explain that in a socio-cultural variations or diversity in classroom, learner diversity, all these aspects teacher should or facilitator should aware of that things. And when we say content knowledge in a pedagogy context, that is basically deconstructing into key components. And this include procedural knowledge, method of solution, all these things are included. And similarly, pedagogical knowledge in a content context is a basically discussion on assessment approach. Assessment is one aspect. Generally, we most of the time giving more emphasis on that, but assessment is a very important concept, and during our classroom teaching learning or classroom discussion, we have to understand the different ways of assessment. There is no single way, so many ways are there, and in a constructivist pedagogy, various tools and various pedagogical knowledge, TPAC, that also suggests many online tools for the student's assessment, and rubrics and portfolio, a lot of different tools are available to assess students' understanding. And that is also a very important assessment for the purpose of the assessment for our aspect of learning. These things we have to understand. This is a Deborah Ball model, a mathematical knowledge model. She suggested, and we almost discussed the various component of this model. Now, let me come to the point which I would like to share with you. This is another topic-specific pedagogical content knowledge, TSPCK, we say. So, the component, most of the component are similar, but the transformation of this topic subject matter knowledge, or even the connection between pedagogical knowledge, the Geddes actually proposed five components: student prior knowledge, curricular saliency, what is difficult to teach, representation, it include analogies, conceptual teaching strategies. So we just have to see, I will explain these five components by giving some examples from science, which I studied during my postdoctoral study. So I would like to share that components details, and then Dr. Rahul ma'am will explain, or even you can also analyze Bhumi's session, whether all these components are covered or not. So that's TCK is a model for transforming the content knowledge of a topic into a form suitable for teaching. And the five components I already discussed. Content knowledge is the amount and organization just now that social months we know. And content knowledge include fact, theories, model, empirical data, concept. Okay. So let me explain the first component of ESPCK, that is a learner prior knowledge, which include misconception. Suppose I'm taking the example of this photosynthesis for a grade 9th. As a teacher, I'm aware that what prior knowledge my learners have. So that that is very important, understanding prior knowledge. And what are the difficulties? I'm not saying directly misconception. After that, analyzing, after giving some open-ended questionnaire, after interviewing, and already they learn something about photosynthesis, and still they have some scientifically wrong notion about that concept, and that is a misconception, or you can say alternative conception. Some researchers also use the term naive concept. So a lot of in science education research, lot of different terminology they are using. Am I audible? Hello.
So your voice is breaking. So can you do anything about it?
Okay, but now I am audible, no?
You're audible, but your voice is breaking, like, you know. So
okay.
Is it?
Can I change my network?
Yes, yes, sir.
Wait up. Am I audible now?
Yes, yes, clear.
Okay, sorry. I think some MTNL network issue there. This is also learning for us.
Yes.
Okay. This misconception, when we are discussing about misconception, students are often resist to give up these ideas, and because it's a little difficult to change that their misconception, and changing student initial conception can be a long process. It take a times and different strategy as a teachers have to use. Curriculum saliency is a second component. I think the first component is very clear, prior knowledge of our learners, and their alternative conception and misconception, or their misunderstanding about that things. Okay. The curricular silence is basically a teacher's understanding. I'm taking the example of photosynthesis. What is the place of that topic in science textbook? How it is related with other subject? And what values or what competencies I, as a teacher, I supposed to share with a student during transforming the content, and at the same time I should know, or I should identify the big ideas from that topics, and subordinate concept or sub concept you can say, and what will be the strategy for scaffolding this learning of that concept, and background awareness of background of the concept, similarly knowing what is most important to understand in that topic, but which big idea I supposed to discuss, and what activities supposed to use. Curriculum silence is considered to influence the teacher decision to leave out certain aspect of topic. That is also again we discuss already in here during that it referred to how deep the teacher decide to go when teaching a specific topic, and also what not to teach. So this awareness of curriculum saliency is very important component, and this little bit we discuss. But again, what is easy or difficult to teach? Understanding what makes a topic easy or difficult to teach in is very crucial. Suppose as a teacher, I am aware that photosynthesis is an abstract concept, and a lot of sub concept in photosynthesis are difficult for the student, and some concept are very easy. So that is understanding is that difficulties and easy concept is very important, and exploration of gatekeeping concept considered difficult to learn and not necessarily misconception, that is also important because that also. And representation, just we discuss, which include analogies, metaphor, lot of example, lot of audio, video, animation, simulation nowadays, or even models for explaining the concept of drawing, diagrams, text, illustration, photograph. Generally, all these things are used for as a representation. And Shulman suggests that a teacher need a philosophical understanding of a subject and the use of most powerful analogies, illustration, example, explanation, simulation, and demonstration. Here one point, because most of our participants are pre-service teacher pre-service teacher. So as a teacher, one have to identify which representation will be appropriate for explanation of a certain concept or a certain topic. And I agree with you that the based on the material or the cost, all things, availability of that things, these include, but as a teacher we have to understand which representation will be very appropriate to explain certain things, so learner we help learner for sense making. Then conceptual teaching strategies. We discussed this point. I prefer the different approaches that teachers use, like whole class teaching, problem first strategy, group work, question answer strategy, and in a constructivist approach, different pedagogical strategies, conceptual teaching strategies are suggested. Inquiry based, pair, even cooperative learning, collaborative learning, exploratory, various conceptual strategies are there. So these are the five components. And now I think here I stop my discussion on this general background of pedagogical content knowledge, and at the same time topic specific pedagogical content knowledge. Now I ask the participant. I am giving you some time. I hope that Rahul ma'am join. Hello, Rahul ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, I am there.
Okay. Would you add something, or we can start our discussion?
Please, I want to say something. I would like to say something.
Yeah, please.
So now, three students, we are all from learning group. I thank you, St. Xavier's Institute, for organizing this type of distance mode learning sessions. at the same time, I want to request you not to get burdened by any kind of information. If you are interested in creating your own knowledge for your practices as a teacher, because we have learned for about 15 years sitting in the class, I don't know what kind of learning experiences are with you, but we know a lot about teachers and teaching during our school education as well as in college education. So don't bother yourself about information, throw away. Now let us try to be with these teachers. I am giving you three examples. These are scenarios related to teaching. Please go through them quickly. First is teacher Asha is assisting learners to construct their understanding of additions and subtraction of integers. Just now, our madam also told us about this and how to think about it. Just go through it and try to answer the question. Move on, scroll it down. Scroll it up. Dr. Narendra, will you?
Can I read?
Yeah, don't read. Scroll it, they will get it.
Okay. At least 1 or 2 minutes, let them read. Okay. I'm giving 1 minute for reading.
Okay.
Okay.
This is the puzzle with which Asha's learners are struggling with.
Is it visible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Please let me know how much time you will require to read. I am giving one because it is a puzzle, so I am giving 2 minutes to read. Ma'am, would you like to make any comment? Rahul ma'am? Hello? Would you
hello?
Like?
Let them give answers to that.
Vini ma'am, can you
ask
the participant to at least Zoom participant to share
their thoughts.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Participants, you all can share your thoughts on the chat so the student coordinators will present it.
Make that question readable to them. Yeah. The question is there. Dr. Narendra, I'd let them see the question.
This is the question. What kind of knowledge does Asha is using for making various decisions related to teaching?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What are the characteristic features of learning culture of our class?
So let them give answers first, then we will discuss.
We can't see any answers coming up in the chat, ma'am. So
please, you start. So slowly they will answer next.
See, now this kind of situation arises in many classes. You must have observed it. Here, Asha is a regular teacher. She wants her learner to work out these puzzles because many times parents request teachers to help learners to work with these kinds of puzzles. And what she has done here, she is not trying to understand because she herself is not aware of what to do because she hasn't tried to solve that puzzle first, just downloaded the puzzle from the internet. And then she is looking for answers from learners. After that, she browses. That means she has not prepared herself with that kind of, but still we can think about her decision. She is using knowledge of rules of subtracting integers, and she is hoping that that rule will help anybody to work out examples related to integers. In this case, some answer is there. She's using concrete to abstract. That is true, concrete to abstract. But she is not doing on her own. That puzzle is presented, is there on the net, and she downloaded it. But she is hoping that her students will do it. But there again, there is a problem. Now look at the answers and explanations, some of the typical answers showing how to do. Miss Manali Modes. Yes. Now look those answers. What we can think about this? Our students are trying to do that puzzle, trying to work out this puzzle, and they are giving their own explanation. Now from these, we can make out that they are also confused with addition and subtraction. Both things are not clear to them. Only one learner showed here that he uses rule for getting answer. So here, instead of helping them or trying to understand the puzzle, she is just running away from the situation, and she is requesting her learners that let us work out with representative rule only, is that subtraction of integers. The rule is known to everybody. It is given in the book. It is in the 6th standards book. See, I know subtracting. So now what are the characteristic features of learning culture of class? Just now Dr. Narendra showed you some information about it, but without information we can, about some answers, we can make out that her learners are doing something, they are putting their efforts. They are boldly presenting their answers. This means there is an open culture, but that open culture is not used by Asha for making learners learn something useful. So let us try to read about second scenario, second classroom situation. Thinking environment, you are correct. Thinking environment is there, but it is not being Asha utilized colleague. By Asha.
Asha colleague Damu also downloaded the same exercise. His learner did practice addition and subtraction of integer using number line as discussed in the textbook. While supervising their individual work, he realized that all his learners are struggling to make meaning of subtraction of negative integers using given representations. He decided to assist them to think of using whatever understanding that they have about subtraction. He modeled a process of thinking in collaboration with learners, supplementing it with board work. He asked following question to himself during this modeling process, giving sufficient time for learners to think about this and comment. These are the questions.
Now that modeling, he decides to do modeling, and his modeling decision is based on many aspects of content learning and about content and as well as students. Go through these questions quickly. Is demonstrating them how to ask questions also, and at the same time he's trying to solve questions with help of them. They are not passive listeners, which is very boring. Scroll it.
Would you like to add any comment or any feedback?
No. Let them read. Just scroll it.
Can I go to next?
Yeah, they will come to know because they have done it just now. Bhumi madam showed them this thing. Yes, you are right. Taking away the thing means subtraction. You are correct. Scroll down. More. Yes, you are right. Salma, you are right. Subtracting is between the number of greater value and lower value. Is it working there? Think again about it. Is it working versus?
Can I scroll? Hello? Hello, ma'am? Hello. Raul ma'am. Raul ma'am.
Connection was not there. So move it. Let them read it completely and we will go to question only, question directly.
Okay. This is another task. Would you like to share?
No, they have completed the task.
Okay.
And it is shown below. The chart shows the task completed by learners.
Can you comment on cognitive apprenticeship? Can I go on next slide? Rahul ma'am? Hello.
Connection is getting logged. It is weak, I think.
What knowledge has Damu to take this up decision while facilitating learning? Is a one question. What kind of learning culture does exist in Damu class? Any comment in chat box from participant?
Critical thinking, one person has written, and students' knowledge has helped him.
As ma'am said, here the students are taking participation. And
let them speak. I hear again, knowing their learners is difficult. Learner difficulty. Teacher first studies learner's difficulties and then takes the decision of modeling. And number of students is more in his class. So naturally he can't help each learner visualizing a problem. You are right, Azima. So what you can say about culture, learning culture in his class? See, first teacher knows, teacher is also facing this puzzle for the first time. Yeah, learning culture, accepting and open, very good, correct. Learner based, true. Introspection, the problem, right, correct. Learning together, this is very important part of this. Student are and teachers both are learning together. While observing learner's work, he is also learning. That is called holistic learning of a learning group. Teacher also develops along with learner's problem. They are also engaged. Student based, correct. Learning based, activity based. So many names you can give it here. And it is not necessary that Lee Shulman tells us about how he is taking decisions. And his decisions come from his profound knowledge that Dr. Narendra mentioned just a while ago about his particular, this specific topic, holistic approach. You are correct, correct. Now, what kind of culture? Yeah, confidence boosted. Yeah, it is more important that why people are not fearing about mathematics. There is no confidence boosting. For example, we teach circle to them.
our circle is always stick to the plane, board, notebook. Why we are not throwing them away out of this plane and allowing it to move in a space? For us, circularity is important, not circle and its properties are important, isn't it? Yeah, yeah, it is important. This is very important part. Thank you, Dr. Vini. Now our scenario three. Please go through that and then. Now this Suzy teacher is conducting mathematical club in her area. Yeah, problem, turning problems into teachable moments, correct. Saishta, thank you for this part. So many points are coming. That's what I am telling, that whenever we come together as a learning and teaching professionals, we should think about these things instead of going to literature available. Let academicians do that. We have to work with our students in our culture, our constraints, and we have to develop our intuition, learn intuition about what to do, why to do, when to do, how to do in a classroom situation. At a time we take decision, during the work we take the decisions. And they are, our decisions are motivated of the culture of the class. We are creating the society, that type of society we want. There is no discrimination, no sexual discrimination, no discrimination of any kind. Yes, book restricted. It is important, not stick to the book, because these are sixth standard students. They use that book, no doubt, help learners to learn how to add these two integers or subtract these two integers. And they are colorful books, good teaching aids are there. But along with that, she is helping learners to expand their ability to apply knowledge in different situations. So this is the thing, and come on, scroll up, Dr. Narendra, may I request you to scroll it? So this is what the problem is here at the end, same problem.
Would this, you like to display the problem?
See, the last problem, I did not see it. It is given in this first chart, minuend and subtrahend and process students have to write. It is not completed here. But it is here, it is one sign that is positive and for negative, and teachers or students are expected to subtract this. Scroll it. Please scroll it. Now, during synchronous online session, there was discussion about following points. See, students are getting points, and some part students did not join about. Able to join this open session. See how, what questions students are asking, that is important. It tells us about working culture of the class. It's a deeper thinking, they are thinking with each other.
Even they are questioning also.
Question and
what decision Suzy madam takes. Can we say cognitive conflict is also created in this situation?
Yeah, here in both situations, Damu's class also, Suzy's class, there is a cognitive apprenticeship. Students are helped to work in a situation where they can think cognitively. Yeah, planning in cognitive domain, you are right. Azima, thank you for that.
Can we go?
Go. Now here is she developed, designed this learning material. Again, if you can compare it with Damu's work, see here, it appears to a third person like me that she wants to make her learners more self-reliant in case of in learning all these new things,
how to apply this thing. So carefully she designed. It takes time. It's a laborious one. Whenever you want to communicate to this particular thing, this is not copied from anywhere. She is thinking about her learner, their queries, and designing this reading worksheet. Okay, scroll it. Now this is self-talk is here. Person is talking to himself. And that is important because self-talk helps one to reflect on one's topic. Yes, this is a personalized learning, correct. Definitely maths and art. It is very important, Azima. Artistic pleasure of solving sums. That's what I want. Because actually I learned a book written by, because in the college when I was teaching in Beer College, I never lectured anybody. First month, only last 15 days, we used to go through books. Why? To satisfy teachers who are examiners. But otherwise, we were creating our learning together, our information together, and our decisions we were making on the basis of what we are doing. So that is very important. Making learners self-reliant. Dr. Narendra mentioned about metaphors and analogies. My analogy is here, I'm not giving net to the person who is hungry so that he can catch fish. I help the person to learn about his environment, what can he do with his environment so that keep it sustainable.
Yeah.
What to do in environment, how to get material to do the things, how to bring together. This is Larry Baker's philosophy. You will get information about it. And he is not actually related to teaching profession, but he, whatever he tells, it is equally important for us. Okay? Now he's thinking, okay, move it. Dr. Narendra, move it.
Would you like to add something here?
No, no. Let them read. They are doing a good work. They are thinking and doing their work. Why should we disturb them?
One minute I am giving. Let them read.
Now students have completed. This activity reminds me of solving equations. Yes, that is true. They are solving equations only. So it won't be difficult for them to enter into studying equation. The second worksheet. See how she designed this second worksheet. हॅलो हा तर आता ती सेकंड वर्षिक मला जरा दिसत नाहीये बघूया आपण काय होतं ते
इट्स कॅन आय कॅन एनलार्ज इट
हा हा
कॅन यू सी नाउ
व्हॉट यू कॅन से अबाउट इट आय कांट सी नाउ बिकॉज आय डोंट नो व्हॉट टू डू विथ दिस आय डोंट
ओके
हा आय कांट सी द स्क्रीन समथिंग हॅपन्ड
See the chat box, what sort of responses we are getting. Can I go to the questions on these worksheets?
Yes, you can go to the questions. Same questions are there.
Uh, after this work, there was an open group discussion through distance mode.
Allow them to read it.
With peers, for example, I, Manju, Janu, did think of representing minion by representing it by additional pair of triangle and circle. It is done in other exercises. But when we shared this idea with Dhan and Yash, they asked for mathematical explanation. We did not able to design any explanation for this. Now I think that revisiting our past learning experiences is very important step in solving problem. Many learners agreed with this conclusion. At the end of discussion, all learners decided to design one puzzle each based on addition and subtraction of integer. What knowledge did Suzy use while she was designing these activities? What are the characteristic feature of learning culture of her learning group?
Now I can't see the screen, Dr. Narendra. You give a comment on their answers.
Okay, but am I audible? No, you are listening.
Yeah.
Okay. Now in that case, we'll ask our Vini ma'am or anyone. They can also share the comment in chat box.
Yes, sir. So
they are sharing in chat box. Chat box is available for me.
Vini ma'am, please read.
There's one, she used mathematical reasoning, logic and conceptual learning.
Yeah, that is very true. More importance to the logical thinking, because logical thinking is a tool they can use anywhere and in any situation. Anyone else? Any other comment?
Ma'am, one which I have written is that she made the learners to be in the shoe of a teacher, because they themselves now develop their own examples. So they would be now more confident.
Yeah.
Then another comment is she used her past learning into the problems. And another comment is activity-based learning is used here.
So here, major aspect of cognitive learning is related to their past experiences and moving them towards their new experiences. That is based on prior knowledge, as it was mentioned by Dr. Narendra. But it is not prior knowledge only restricted to the rules of doing algorithms, but they are coming out of that, expanding on that, and then using it, applying it, that is application level. It is also related to creativity of the learners to think about differently about the things. That is more important. Students got the answer, but they did not give it because they are asked to give evidence for that or explanation for that. And for that, they were thinking about it.
Yes. So learning requires interaction and learning together, and learning by doing, building new knowledge.
Yeah.
Students from known to unknown and finally creating something new.
No.
Emphasize on being little minds but greater thinking.
Hmm.
Emphasis on being little.
And this is done, actually done. I'm not, this scenario is not very done without any experience. I designed it using my own experiences. And if we give learners open space, we don't comment about anything about a wrong or right answer, but we take that answer into consideration and do something with it, do new learning, do mathematics with it, and come up with new suggestions, new conclusions, new results like that. Okay, anybody want to say anything about teacher's decision? Their teacher, what kind of teacher is she? She is a regular teacher. In spite of that, she is conducting online mathematics club.
With this method, teacher taught students to work in group that will inculcate value of helping each other and group working.
Learning from each other. Learning from each other also.
And also, ma'am, making them independent learners.
Independent learner, very true. Shall we move to another scenario? There is some time.
Yes, ma'am.
No, we are taking now task. Scenario is finished, ma'am.
Yeah, I know, but that they are also scenarios only.
Okay. The working with traction, age group 9 to 10. Actually, Bhumi.
Yes, sir.
We discuss a little bit about this.
Hello, Midhi madam. Midhi
madam. Yes, ma'am.
Can
yes,
I ma'am. Talk to you?
Yes, ma'am.
I am seeing only Zoom. Why can't I see my screen? I did not do anything.
Ma'am, you click on the icon, no, down. Zoom icon.
I think, ma'am, don't do anything. Otherwise, you get
me that sometimes minimize ho jata hai, sir.
So what should I do?
Actually, wo Zoom icon hai na, ma'am, niche. Just click on that.
I got it. Yes, thank you very much. Now, I'm requesting all persons to revisit, reflect on their personal experiences at the age of 9 and 10 sitting in a classroom. That is the very good way of learning about teaching intuitively. I did it like that because I had many problems with mathematics learning, but then I was forced to take up a job. Actually, I was not willing to doing any job, but because I thought that it is a very difficult job. Teaching is a very difficult job, but anyhow, I entered in and then I decided to develop myself professionally, walking my way alone, walking my talk alone, by doing this reflective thinking. That time I was not aware of the concept of empathy, but here I used to think about my learning experiences, how my teachers were teaching me, how my parents teaching me, what was given in the book and how it troubled me. And on the basis of that, I designed my own teaching learning experiences, but because of, teacher taught them. Okay. What else? We have to finish. Very few minutes are remaining now. Hello, move ahead. Let them think. They will think. Yeah. Teacher here is not sure, confident that these two fractions are equivalent. So she asks one more question to herself. And she got the data. She gets the data. When she utters the word more, instead of saying equal value, here is the data. or sort of personal experiences of learners, reflective teaching. Yeah, very good. This is actually needed. We should spend much time in reflective learning. Then only we can develop process for helping, assisting them. Instead of teaching, facilitating, assisting. Okay? Did you get this material? Then we will move ahead.
Yes, yes.
We can post them, no? This, after this.
Yes. Yeah, we will share entire things.
Empathy is very important. It is different from sympathy. And we have to take into consideration phenomenological aspects of social learning processes. This is social learning situations. Teacher is wondering about this unexpected situation that arose in the classroom. Should teacher announce you be afraid to her and study her questions? Okay. Move ahead. Move up.
What sort of knowledge base?
What sort of knowledge base should teacher need to apply in tackling this type of problems?
With respect to the processes of learning and facilitation.
Now here are some data about learners' explanation and their thinking. Some said both are equal. Here is the, some said 5-5 is more, and they are giving reason for that. And it is also correct. And everybody says that he is correct. All learners are saying that he is correct. See here, how whole out of whole he is thinking about like that. Come with another slide.
Can I go ahead?
Yeah. Yes, knowing the concept of parts from a whole. Yes, true. Actually, the assumptions related to these fractions are not made public clearly. How to think about wholes? What to think about wholes? Whether the wholes are equal or not, that is very important. But they are not declared as knowledge. They are assumed. But students, they find many problems with that. Is why we assume. But assumption should be made public, isn't it? Atima, what do you think? Hands-on activity helps you learn. But only hands-on will not suffice. We need to think, why are we doing it? Why we are not doing? Now, for take examples. Why she is drawing this girl, particular girl, she drawn this, her explanation. See. Now go for another explanation. They can make out from this figure. Narendra Mohan. Nah. I made both using rectangles. Yeah, you are correct. But in this case, we can describe with concrete situations only. Can be described in concrete situations also. For example, now look for this answer. This particular boy explained to me that when somebody comes, mommy adds same quantity of rice or atta to the original quantity. Daily experience, yeah. They are applying their knowledge of fractions to their daily experiences. I don't remember, but one of my teacher used to tell me that when people are poor, in low income, with low income, lower strata,
their children live in efficiency apartment. I just now remember that word. Yeah, that is true. But he is reading it in that way. He is thinking about it in this way. When the question was asked about more, what is more? He is using this thinking. So that is called efficiency apartment, where mummy is cooking or father is cooking and children are observing what they are doing. Suddenly somebody comes, she suddenly adds something. Sometimes she had made balls for rolling chapatis, and if she knows that somebody is visiting their house, again she makes those balls small. Means many things they are observing. They are not sitting in their study room. They are not only with their peers. Their houses are open. Anybody can enter in, come out. This rural situation, this is. And in when we were living and we were observing this, when we were young, our all environment is like this. So they are with their own experiences about mathematics. Yeah, they are there in their minds. And when we are trying to lecture about this fraction, and you remember this, learn this, and we are bombarding them with our own models, what they will be doing, what they are thinking about this mathematics, and will they fear about it, or will they work about it? Now, madam is asserting she is not branding it as their misconcept. She knows why that particular child is saying like that. See, her learners are comfortable. They all say this explanation is also logically correct. There's no logic behind it. So when we want to make six upon six, then you can have six things, they are equal. When you mean five upon five, you can take five things and five are equal. It's five upon five. That is also the same thing. But it is, he is not thinking. He is thinking in terms of more. That more created the problem. Should teacher avoid this kind of situations or not? Again, depends on approach towards teaching. Approach towards your commitment. What you want to give your learners. How you help them to boost their confidence. All the time we are talking about confidence, isn't it? Okay, anybody wants to comment? Are sharing equally? Yeah, there are different ways of sharing equally. Getting more material, sharing among more people, equal material, sharing among less number of people. And people, now the girl who was talking to me, she was telling me they are five in their family, grandfather, father, and her brother, and mother and girl. So usually what happens, mother gives larger share to
hello. I think she is
yes, he is
discussing about gender equity.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, we will read the next one also.
Yes. Madam is there actually, but we can't hear her.
All these are the reading material actually now.
Yes.
Just we have to read it.
Sir, in 5 minutes it will be done.
Yeah. You just tell me, can we go ahead, another one?
No, sir. Yes, sir.
This basically learning environment is actually
Hello.
Yes, here.
Yeah, yeah. Internet connection is unstable, so I will finish it as quickly as possible.
Yes.
Narendra sir, do you want to make any comment about this?
Yeah, we just share about the designing learning environment. Different representations using for a different concept, just for fraction, various material.
So I am describing the situation to the persons who are thinking about these things, how the situation arrived, the teacher did not use. The teacher used all sorts of material. In spite of that, they are coming up with this kind of thing. The teacher taught them fraction, they are doing it for about 2 weeks, I told you in the beginning only. So these are the questions for you to think about this. There is one aspect in that concept map and Dr. Narendra presented. There is a mathematics at the horizon of understanding. Dr. Narendra, please scroll it up. See.
Deverable.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, that is second. What Dewey says, John Dewey, teacher should allow learners. Will you read, Dr. Narendra, please? Teacher should allow.
Yeah. According to Dewey, teacher should allow learner to interact around important question as member of learning communities and develop knowledge together. Knowledge itself is seen as a less definite and more situated in an assumption and agreed upon ways of learning shared by a community. There is more attention to question of mathematical argument and discourse, method of proof, tools of representation.
I always worked with learners, young or teacher educators, teacher learners, with this convinced. If our knowledge is not definite, why to bother about rules and ideals and anything else? When you make yourself free from all these clashes, you will be able to create, don't waste time in giving information. When you are working with this unstable net situation, if you spend your time on in giving information, deliver that PPTs to persons, they will read on their own leisurely, and then we will work together. What I do, I prefer to do. Instead of wasting time, we should invest time in analyzing the situations and then creating personal knowledge first known to us that is more suitable to our situation. Okay, and then again, teachers believe what Deborah Bob said.
Can I read? Hello? There are some questions, how to work for fulfilling responsibility and commitment by managing various constrained, uncertain, ambiguous, and complex situations. How many teachers did experience this kind of meaning construction of knowledge, communication, communicating it to the other using various modes, means, and methods by working individually as well as collaboratively? How will you design learning environment in a different setup, face-to-face, online, synchronous, asynchronous, offline, etc. For this inclusive learning community that is flexible enough for adapting it to learner thinking and explanations. So these are the questions as a teacher we have to ask ourselves.
So I would like to listen to comments of learners. Our group, comments from the groups.
This one is the last.
Last is important. somebody must be there to challenge our beliefs. So you can challenge yourself. If you are thinking critically about what happens in your classroom, take cognizance out of that, get messages, right kind of messages from that. You can read Vignesh written by many teachers. I used to help my learners, in B.Ed. college, student teachers, to write Vignesh about them. And then they used to use phone for giving messages to each other and come up with nice ideas in new class. So that is more important. But I would like to listen to comments in that situation where teacher is getting more info, more different kind of various kinds of explanations and models of mathematics, what they should do. Hello? Okay, if they are not.
Any comment in chat box?
No, sir. No, not as of now.
Okay.
So we please can stop. Ma'am.
Rahul, ma'am? Please summarize.
So, yes, I summarize in this particular PowerPoint presentation. This reframe, this is a summary only.
Okay.
This last, they are correct. All answers are correct. They are good. Then we have to remember something for the purpose of larger group where we communicate our ideas of mathematics. And in that case, some rules we need to take up. Otherwise, there will be a chaos when we are using these numbers in our day-to-day life. Smaller group, it's okay. So I'm not saying that they are misconcepts. They are concepts on their own right. And our new researches are being done that all people are wired to learn mathematics, science, and they have their own strategies about learning it. They are their own models of visualizing it. And if we force them to accept without any critical opportunity for critical thinking, creative thinking, it will be a battlefield where people learn away from learning mathematics, away from learning science. That should not happen. Open-ended questions. You are right. This is a good comment. So this is the summary. Thank you, Amarjan.
Thank you, Dr. Narendra Deshmukh, Dr. Satyavati Rahul. You all have given us a different view of looking at it, how to see pedagogy, how to see your content in a way that you can express it properly to the students. And ma'am also has helped us to understand how to deal with the learners. And thank you, ma'am, for sharing your own personal experience about teaching that also gave a personal touch. So I would request Alsona to thank the speakers while you can wait along a bit as I'm going to share some research results of a small action research which was conducted and the participants had participated in this. Alsona?
Yes, thank you, Vani ma'am. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for the second session. On behalf of SXI Manager Father Blaze, Principal Dr. Sosamma, Staff in Charge Dr. Vinny, I would like to extend a hearty vote of thanks to our speaker, Satyavati Madam and Narendra Sir. Indeed, it was such a great opportunity for all of us to hear your session on pedagogical content knowledge. This session has enabled us to understand the importance of PCK for classroom instructions. It is said that a teacher can make or break students, and in order to make students, it's important for a teacher to be able to understand their own competency level. Today's session has definitely helped us teachers to introspect about our own teaching and whether it is really fruitful and useful to the students. The various scenarios and tasks presented to us today have helped us to understand it with more clarity. So thank you once again, Satyavati ma'am and Narendra sir, for giving us your precious time and sharing your experience and vast knowledge with all of us. Thank you again.
Thank you.
I'm sharing the research results of a small study which was conducted. All of us are in the lockdown period and we wanted to know the voices of the mathematics teachers. So therefore this study was conducted and I'm just presenting you the results. It will not take much time. It is self-explanatory. Everyone should know what was the outcome of the Google form which was sent to you all related to the problems faced by mathematics teachers. So these were the three questions which were put up. What are the problems faced by teachers in online teaching? What are the problems faced by students during online teaching? And are the skills required different in online mode of teaching? So we had 463 responses and we really thank all the participants for participating in this. So teachers had to be prepared to give online teaching due to the pandemic. Some got training, others didn't, and yet conducted the online classes. So do you think mathematics teachers face more challenges than other teachers? So you can see the results are up on the screen. Most of the teachers have faced the challenges. It is difficult to display mathematical formulas and work out sums in an online mode. So they say it is somewhat true. The teachers have tried to do it. So we have a 50-50% there. Mathematics teachers have to master effective communication skills as well as online teaching skills for effective teaching. So it is true. They had to master these skills for online teaching. Main objectives of mathematics teaching learning are not achieved through online teaching of mathematics. And you can see not really, almost 50% divide in that question. The online platform do not provide tools for effective mathematics teaching. And you can see the strongly agree part is very less. And you can see the teachers have tried to adjust with the online mode. Mathematics teachers cannot cater to students fully in an online mode. So you can see most of the teachers have agreed, but again, you can see a 50-50 divide in that. To what extent do you think mathematics teachers are facing challenges as compared to other teachers? To some extent, that is what most teachers have answered. 65% of teachers have said to some extent. Communicating mathematical concepts in an online situation is difficult. So teachers have said that it is difficult. You can see a 50% saying agree and strongly agree there. And the big concept which we can see is that online teaching is challenging and it is difficult to cater to students' needs in mathematics. So skills required, digital skills and student engagement skills. So you can see digital skills, technical skills and online tools, online communication skills and student engagement. Creating an online learning environment was challenging and toggling between different digital tools to keep students engaged is what teachers are doing. And challenges faced by teachers in different areas, subject, technology and student learning. In subject, the display of certain mathematical concepts and the explanation is becoming very difficult online. In the technology part, the internet issues are there. So the voice breaks, you get logged off. And these kind of issues are there. Knowledge of appropriate use of technology is lacking. Disconnectedness with the learner
as you are in the online mode and there is no special attention given to the students. Student learning, understanding of the student is not assessed by the teacher. Teacher does not know whether the students have understood the concept. Learning styles, learning difficulties cannot be tackled. Monitoring of students' work cannot be done. Checking of the work is not done. Collaborative learning is absent and less time is given to complete the lesson. Students also face more challenges. They are also facing technological problem, learning problems, lack of attention from the teacher, expressing the problems online, and definitely mathematics phobia exists in online teaching also. So thank you for your participation for this small action research. And this time also we have put up an action research and I hope many people participate in that. So I request Alsona to propose the vote of thanks, the total vote of thanks.
May I take 1 minute, madam?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, if anybody is interested in conducting self-study research or smaller classroom action research, I am there to help you. And again, I have written many articles about mathematics and science teaching in different classrooms, different type of classrooms. And my college also, they are in, most of them are Marathi, but few are in English also. They can visit Academia Asia for that.
They can visit, ma'am, can you repeat?
Hello?
Ma'am, they can visit what, ma'am? There is a website.
Join Academia.
Join Academia.
Okay. Okay.
We can share the link with the participants later.
Sure. Yes, Alsona, you can go.
Okay, so I would like to thank our dear manager, Father Blaise, and Principal Dr. Sosamma Samuel for allowing us to continue with this Maths webinar series 4. I would especially like to thank our staff in charge of Mathematics Pedagogy Unit, Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, for as usual motivating and encouraging us to continue with this online Maths webinar series. Thank you, ma'am, for your support and encouragement. Next, I would like to thank our student coordinators, Riesel, Clarice, Rachel, Nisha, Vaseem, Daya, and Alsona for as usual being the strong team behind the curtain and providing technical support and completing all the preparations for this webinar. And lastly, I would like to thank all the participants of both first and second session. Without each and every one of you on Zoom as well as YouTube, this series wouldn't be successful, and we hope that you are taking back something with you from both of the today's session. So with this, I would like to end my word of thanks.
And so now some instructions for the participants.
Yes, this instruction is regarding the feedback form. Earlier we had put a message on WhatsApp group saying that due to some technical glitch, we won't be sending the feedback today, but our team was able to solve the glitch. So the feedback form is ready. After the end of this meeting, we will be posting the feedback link on the WhatsApp group, just like for any other webinars that we have done. Taking into consideration the feedback of the last series, this time we are keeping the feedback form open till 11 p.m. So all the participants are kindly requested to fill the feedback form till 11 p.m. While filling the feedback form, please make sure that you put in your correct email address, or else the certificate will not be delivered to you. Also, if you don't receive the certificate, then please wait for 30 minutes and check your spam folder. And if after 30 minutes it's not coming, then you can message any of the student coordinators regarding the certificates. So that was all instruction for the certificates. Thank you.
Thank you, Alsona. So thank you all participants for the participation, and we will keep you posted about the next webinar series. And thank you for joining us all throughout. Father, would you like to say anything, or should I end the meeting? Madam, is there?
No, I don't think ma'am is there.
Yeah. Okay,
you can end it, Vinnie. You can end the meeting. It is pretty late.
Thank you, Father. Yeah. Thank you, Father. Mm-hmm. Okay, Father. Thank you.